Everything I Love, Cole Porter. If I were Lord Byron, I'd write you, sweet siren, a poem inspiring, a killer diller, oh. Too bad I'm no poet, I happen to know it, but anyway, here's a rondelay that I wrote last night about you. You are to me everything, my life to be everything. When in my sleep you appear, fair skies of deep blue appear. Each time our lips touch again, I yearn for you, oh, so much again. You are my favorite star, my haven in heaven above. You are everything I love.
My name is Ashley Pezzotti, and welcome to my mini lesson series. Throughout this series, we're going to be talking about transcription. And for the purposes of these little lessons, I've decided to go with Dexter Gordon's solo on Just Friends. And it's an incredible solo filled with amazing language. For the purposes of these videos, however, we're only going to focus on the first chorus. And I think that it is important to note for students who are interested in finding their own solos and looking to transcribe, that you do consider the key. And the reason I picked this solo is because it's comfortable in my range, which means that this language is usable in my practice. If I were going to go and take a solo of my own, I could use this language because it's familiar and in a comfortable key for me. The first thing I do when I approach transcribing an instrumental solo is listening. And I know that seems a little bit basic, but I do believe that there are two types of listening. The first one is passive listening, and the second is active listening. So the first kind of listening is probably what the majority of, you know, non-musicians do, which is, you know, you have your music on, it's kind of in the background, you could be scrolling Facebook or, you know, driving or whatever it is that you're doing. You're listening to it, but you're not really paying attention to what's going on. It's sort of in the background of whatever it is that you're doing. The second kind of listening is your active listening, and that's where you have no distractions whatsoever, and you're just solely focusing on that recording. And I used to be of the thought that active listening was the most important thing, but now I've come to realize that they're both important. For me personally, I like to start with the passive listening. And this means that any time that I'm listening to something or doing an activity, so if I'm, you know, painting my nails or walking my dog or driving in the car, whatever it is that I'm doing, that recording that I've decided to transcribe, that's playing on repeat. I'm not really paying attention to what's going on. It's sort of, again, like I mentioned with the passive listening, it's in the background, but it's constantly being played. So before I even decide to approach sitting down and transcribing a solo, that's the first thing that I do. And I feel like it sort of subconsciously seeps in when it's the only thing that I have playing. But again, it's always in the background. I'm not really doing any work at this point. I'm just sort of associating myself with this recording and making sure that it is as ingrained in me as possible. Once I've done enough passive listening, so I feel like this is something I'll do over a couple of days. And once I've done that, then I'll decide to sit down and begin the active listening. And that's when, you know, you're hyper-focused, you're really paying attention to all of the details, you have no distractions whatsoever. So I really do believe that both passive and active listening are important, and that is my first step to transcribing an instrumental solo.
Hey people, right. That page that you just saw is the cycle of fourths, moving clockwise. Cycle of fourths are very, very important because what they do, they go through the whole keys. And what I normally say to my students is, learn the cycle of fourths by memory, memorize it. You know, you got C, F, B flat, E flat, A flat, D flat, G flat, and so forth. Okay, it goes around the clock. Think of it like a clock, like the clock behind me, as in numbers. There are 12 of them, and they each have a different kind of tone and color. And what I do, I go through it, round and around, and then start using permutations. So basically, what I do is that I go through the whole series and make sure that I can get every single one. So, go to the G, and you notice how I'm climbing. So I really kind of like go do do do, and then down again, do do do, and then down again, and then keep climbing up. And when I get to, let's say, my G, I start climbing down. And then I'll try and make it into like a cyclic pattern, so just keep going around. Thank you. again, don't forget to breathe, of course. So what I'll do now, I'll demonstrate it in a way where it kind of like takes on a different kind of metronomic timing. So. You hear that? So once you've got it down under your fingers, then you can kind of like keep playing with it, doing lots of different time signatures with it, you know. So all that is from just knowing the cycle of fourths, just keep going around the cycle, memorize it, make sure that you can absolutely know it inside out, okay? Get it down cold. So what you'd have noticed on that sheet that I showed you, that on the left-hand side there are these permutations, they're numbers, like a number system, you know, and they, well, I've done like seven of them. So I'm going to show you the first one. So each one I use as a number to go around the cycle of fourths, okay? So if you know your major scales, then it should be easy because it's all to do with numbers, okay? So this first one is 1, 2, 1, 2 of every scale or every chord that is going around the cycle of fourths. So, you know, 1, 2, 1, 2 of C, 1, 2, 1, 2 of F, and 1, 2, 1, 2 of B flat. I guess you know what I'm talking about. Okay, so listen to this. And then I go to the F. So, as well as it being an exercise, it's actually very, very musical as well. You know, you can use any of these in your improvisations, you know. So, these are the sort of things that I heard Joe Henderson use when I got to see him live, fortunately. And the cycle of fourths is something that Coltrane used as his way of getting the concept of giant steps, kind of moving across the cycle of fourths, so to speak. So this is where he got the idea from, and then developed it from there. So going back to the 1, 2, 1, 2 again, so. So that's number one, and you can just keep playing with that until you get it. Very, very good for the fingers, very, very good for the technique. You know, I use this as my warm-ups every single day when I get on the saxophone, and yeah, you can do it on any instrument, piano, guitar, whatever, bass. So, I think the first person I heard do this many years ago was Cannonball Adderley. He did a solo on Unit 7, and he went dabba 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 dabba. It's just absolutely wonderful. If you get to hear the Nancy Wilson and Cannonball album and listen to his solo on Unit 7, you know, he'll go. But with what he did 2-1-2-1. 2-1-2-1. Using the cycle of fourth. Okay, but that permutation is 1-2-1-2. So you can switch it around as well. Okay, so that is permutation number one.
Hi everyone, welcome to this micro series on jazz piano, and today I'm going to talk to you about how I practice left hand voicings. It's very easy in jazz piano to spend all our time thinking about the right hand, but so much of what the right hand plays sounds way better with a really, really strong left hand. So let's talk about my way of practicing left hand chord voicings using two props. See you in a sec. So here is one of the best way to add some freshness into your left hand voicings is to think about keeping them all within a certain register. I like my left hand to be roughly in and around middle C, just south of middle C, with my thumb just intersecting middle C here. And the best way to work on this, I came prepared with props, is to have two pencils. I'm going to set one there. I'm going to set one there so you can see I'm an octave below middle C and G just above middle C. This is my entire piano for my left hand voicings when I'm playing in this style of music. This is not really rootless voicings because I can have some rooted voicings and they still sound okay, so I'm fine with that. But really what this does is it likes to keep everything in close position and it avoids everything being in root position, because you can't play a B minor 7 or something with in a rooted voicing because my B is out of bounds there and my top note would be out of bounds there. So let's get a listen to how this would work over one chorus of There Will Never Be Another You. So this is using just these notes within the two pencils. It's also important to note that sometimes you can play more than one version on more than one chord. So the E flat major lasts for two bars. There's nothing stopping me playing. Or I have loads of different options there. Rather than just sticking to one, putting it down with it, you know, make it interact with the right hand as well. I hope that was super clear. Really, by having these constraints on what the left hand can do, it does make you think about where we have to place the left hand and reconfiguring voicings. But for me, that part of the piano in and around middle C is just the nicest sounding area of the piano for chord voicing. So go and get practicing. Get your pencils on the piano. I'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye.
Hi everyone, my name's Sara Colman. It's lovely to be with you again for Sligo Jazz, doing some singing exercises, getting your voices warmed up, and hopefully lots of you will be able to be with us at the end of the week there to do to learn a song with me. In the meantime, we're going to do exercises that are based around that song and the difficult bits of that song, but they can stand alone too. So if you can't make it for that, these will be fine. Just on their own, just to help you warm your voice up. To start with, let's get our bodies ready. So nice and tall, standing up or sitting, sitting up out of your waist, nice and tall. Let's just do a shoulder roll back and down. And again, another one back and down. And let's stretch those necks out. So look off to the left and not too much. And back again, ease off. And let's push that stretch a little bit further And one more time, ease it off and then push it a bit further. We're all spending so much time now on the line that we spend a lot of time looking straight ahead. So we've got to make sure that we keep our necks nice and relaxed and stretched. You could probably do that a little slower at your own pace. You'll get a feeling for how your neck's doing. Nice and tall. Let's take a breath in through the nose and blow it out. And really blow it out this time like you're blowing out candles. And shoulder roll. You want to stand up nice and tall, feeling like your head's being held with a golden thread. And we're going to stop today by doing some lip trills, which are always my go-to for warming up straight away. Really quick warm up. Now, we can either do them like this, which some people call it bubbling, lip trills, all different names. Sometimes you might need a little help with your muscles here. That can help. So give it a go. And we're going to do a wide ranging intervals. So to start with, we're going to go thirds and fifths. Follow along with me. You need a lot of puff. That's it. Keep going. Around as well. Really slide in between. That's it, nice and tall. You might run out of air, but don't worry, keep going. One more with a bright smile. If you can smile when you're bubbling, keep your forehead lifted. Let's do a bigger interval. We're going to go up to the fifth and up to the octave. Back. Here we go. And again. Keep going. Big breath. Sliding around. Keep connected to the sound all the time. One more. Here we go. See if you can practice that a couple more times before tomorrow and we move on to a new exercise. See you tomorrow.
Hi Sligo family, Shannon Barnett here. I'm looking forward to presenting some micro lessons this week, and today we're going to learn about a really fantastic musician named Lil Hardin Armstrong. Armstrong was born in 1898 in Memphis in Tennessee, but she later moved to Chicago. And I suppose she was probably, unfortunately, well known for being Louis Armstrong's wife for a long time. He had about four, I think. But actually, she was in her own right an amazing piano player, composer, also singer, band leader, seamstress, restaurant owner. So really all around an incredible woman.
Roses. Go out and bring me some red roses. Oh.
Lil also played with Louis in the Hot Fives and Sevens project, where it's thought that she also did a lot of the arranging as well. She composed so many pieces. It's unbelievable, actually, including Just for a Thrill, which later became a really big hit for Ray Charles. And she also composed this piece, Strutting with Some Barbecue. Lil had many talents, and one of those was being a seamstress. She actually made Louis suits for a long time. But not only that, she was probably his biggest champion. She encouraged him in all aspects of his career, even pushing him to leave the King Oliver Band and go to New York. So I guess, yeah, she definitely made some sacrifices for his career, and as such was probably not as well known as Louis. Lil died in 1971, actually not that long after Louis. She was playing a memorial concert for him and died after the final note of playing the St. Louis Blues. Unfortunately, not so many people came to her funeral as they did for Louis, for example. And I also read that in 2002, as of 2002, no one had actually collected the royalties for her composition since the 70s. I'm not sure if that changed, but so she basically died without having a lot of family connections, and sad story. But we're very thankful that she gave us all this great music, over 150 compositions, and I'm still searching through all of them, and there are some real gems there. So I'll include a list here at the end about some recordings that you can check out, and hope you enjoy them.
Thank you. Hi there, this is Phil Robson. I'm going to give you a crash course in a very simple form of what we call in the jazz world comping, which comes from the word accompaniment. And it's basically a very simple way of playing through chord sequences using really minimal materials. So what I'm thinking of is the kind of accompaniment you'd hear in a small group, like a quartet with maybe bass drums and maybe a saxophone player and a singer or a trumpet player, trombone, whatever the combination might be, small group jazz. And I'm going to play through my sequence, not playing big full chords, but very simply using just the thirds and sevenths of the chords alone and nothing else. This is sometimes called, people call it voice leading. Voice leading is can be more sophisticated with more added notes like ninths and stuff like that. Thirds and sevenths is also voice leading. So if you want more information of this, you've never heard of this before, if you Google voice leading thirds and sevenths, you'll find a ton of information of it out there. But I thought it might be nice to just give a very quick demonstration as best I can. So what I've done is I've recorded a bass line just with an octave pedal. So I'll come to that in a minute. So the other thing, the other aspect is the rhythmic aspect. So I'm going to use my thirds and sevenths. It's in the key of B flat, this one. So instead of a big full chord, turn my guitar up so you can hear. So instead of a big full chord, I'm just going to use these notes and change through the sequence using just thirds and sevenths. So I'm going to grab my earphones so I can hear the bass line. Okay. So the other thing to quickly mention, although it's very, very important, is the rhythm. And a way into this that would be really good is what I would, I guess, call a Charleston rhythm. I'm not sure if somebody else would have a better kind of a term for it, but it's a very simple kind of slightly syncopated rhythm, which is on beat one and the off of beat two. So in time it would be like 1, 2, 3, 4. Like that. And that's a great starting point. You can add to that later, but if you start from that point, you'll be in the right territory. So here's my bass line. I'll play that and I'll let it go through a whole thing without playing. And then when it gets to the end, I'll count myself in and I'll play a couple of choruses of comping with thirds and sevenths in that Charleston rhythm. Okay, here is that. E flat 7, E flat 7, B flat 7, G 7, C, F, B flat. Thank you. it's a bit of a crash course in comping, in in-depth thing. But the good thing is it's so easy to find chord shapes and stuff like that now. So if you want to add to your chord vocabulary, you can just look up jazz guitar shapes and you'll find all sorts of information. But I hope that gives you just a feel for today of how it might sound and a way into it. So hope you enjoy. Thank you.
Hello. Welcome back to Virtual Sligo. I'm still here, been waiting all year. I talked to you about different feels when you're playing the drums. I think a lot of people overlook the two feel. So that when we're playing the feel of four, we've got this feeling of one, two, three, a four, a one, a two, a three, and there's movement. But two feel is more of a holding pattern. One, two, a one, two, a three, four. And we often play it just with shorter sounds on our hat. One, two, three, ba, dee, ba, ba, dee, da. Here the bass drum's one and three. Dee, da. Open the hi-hat here, so it's not holding tight. You're not going to push me anywhere. And for the bridge, we're going to go to four. I mean, you can play just on the snare drum with two feet. You can play one, two, three, four. What do we say here? But the key to a lot of it is the bass drum just playing on one and three. If you get your feet sorted out, it's enormously beneficial to your time. Well, it has been to mine, so I imagine it will be to yours. So, two feel, four feel. Very important part, and it gives really good signposts to the people that you're playing with as to what section of the music you're in at that time. And the more that everybody knows where they are, the more that they can take risks. So everybody wins. Okay, thank you.
Hi there, I'm Federico Malaman and welcome to my channel. Today we will be doing a very cool exercise. On top of helping developing the major scale triads in all keys, we will be experimenting with the famous metric modulation. Don't worry, it seems hard, but for us bass players it's much easier than for our drummer friends, because the real metric modulation is performed by them. In this case, the feel will change between 6/8 and 3/4 while maintaining the same speed of the eighth notes. We will just keep playing eighth notes in both time signatures. The thing that changes really is that in 6/8 we will be grouping notes in threes, while in 3/4 we will group them in twos. That's all. Before starting the exercise, I will explain very slowly what to play. I suggest you to download the PDF before playing the exercise with me. You will also find a backing track with the different tempos. Don't forget to like the video and subscribe if you haven't. And let me know in the comments below what you'd like me to cover in the future videos. No more talking, let's play! Thank you.
Thanks for watching my videos. Subscribe to my channel and hit the bell button to be the first to see my new videos. If you love these videos, check out more of my content here on the right. Until the next time, keep slapping!
Hi, Michael Buckley here. Great privilege to play this year for Sligo Jazz 2021, and it was great to do these short tutorials for you. So let's get to it. I want to start with three elements to whatever mode or scale you're practicing. This can be for singers, horn players, you know, piano players, whatever. It translates, most of it translates over. So if let's take a scale I like to teach students, bebop scale. So simple major scale, add the dominant seventh. Okay, so when I say three elements, so one element is the mode or the scale, so in this case the bebop scale. So the second element, as you might hear there, is the dynamic. Very important. When I practice every time, I'm conscious that I'm going to use a dynamic. I don't just want to play one mode or one scale or one pattern all the time without bringing other elements into it. So you can practice my dynamic. So you got that crescendo. So keep it low down the bottom and, you know, get higher as we go up. So we get that good crescendo, and that really gives a swinging feel and a really nice vibe to it. Okay, now the third element for us saxophone players is where I'm thunging the notes. So if I'm playing this C, my first note, we're in the key of C, what I'm doing is blowing the first note and tonguing the second note. So it gives a certain swing and a certain attack. So even when I'm playing a bebop phrase or so the tonguing is very important. So think of that one. Blowing, blow first note and tonguing the second.
Hi everyone, my name's Dermot McNeill. I'm a bass player living and working in London, originally from Northern Ireland. I'd like to present today a series of short video lessons on an exercise and concept that I use in my practice schedule to really solidify and improve fundamental timekeeping and sense of time and pulse. Also to encourage and promote repertoire of tempos. So we're going to be looking at 40 beats per minute, 80 beats per minute, 160 beats per minute, and 320 beats per minute with this exercise, which I'm going to outline now for you just by clapping and vocalizing some rhythms. So the first, tempo we're looking at is 40 beats per minute, and we're just going to clap the crotchet pulse. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3. Okay, so that's our first tempo. 40 beats per minute. Metronome on each beat of the bar. Next, we're going to double the tempo from 40 beats per minute to 80 beats per minute, metronome on 2 and 4 of each bar. 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2, 2 and 2, 3 and 2, 4. 1 and 2, 2 and 2, 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. Okay, so moving from 80 beats per minute, we're going to double the time again into 160 beats per minute. Metronome is going to be on beat 4 of each bar only. 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, and 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 1, and a 2, and a 3, and a 4, and a 1, and a 2, and a 3, and a 4, and 1, and 2, and 3, and 4. Okay, so moving up again then from 160 beats per minute to 320 beats per minute. Metronome's going to be on beat 3 of every other bar. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3. And then we can start to try and move between these different tempos. 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Thank you. That's the first lesson. In the next lesson, we're going to look at applying this concept or these exercises to the instrument in developing basic techniques on the double bass. Thank you.
Hello there. Hello, Sligo. Very, very happy to be involved in this virtual jazz festival this year. So the first little thing I would like to talk about for this first micro lesson is warming up, because I think it's a good place to start. Now, the thing that I get asked most often as a kind of lead commercial trumpet player is, how do you play high notes? So in part to answer that, and I might go into that in a bit more detail in another lesson, but for now, warming up. People, the amount of times I've heard people warm up like this. You know, starting there somewhere. In a nutshell, basically the single easiest thing you can do to help yourself with trumpet playing in general is not start away down there, because the rest of the range is kind of like away up there. So it's like standing looking at a really tall building. So actually, it would be much more useful to start, say, rather than that low C, or even better still, why not make the C above that your kind of easiest note to play? If you were to start your day there, rather than away down at low C, it means that the rest of the instrument isn't so far away, you know, because you're playing more in the middle of your range. Especially, you know, if you're playing lead trumpet stuff, you're generally going to be playing between that C and top C for most of the time, and even a kind of second trumpet or a third trumpet part, and sometimes even a fourth trumpet part isn't really going to go much below that a lot of the time. So you're going to spend most of your time in that range. So why start your warm-up away down there. It doesn't make a lot of sense, right? So that would be my very first kind of go-to very quick fix for improving your range. Start your warm-up somewhere more in the middle of the register that you're used to playing in.